Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee in 2021. We've received apologies from committee member Willie Coffey, and I would like to ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on business on our agenda today is a decision on whether to consider items 4 and 5 in the agenda in private. Are we agreed? Agreed. The second item on our agenda today is to take evidence as part of the committee's consideration of the Scottish Government's local governance review. We will take evidence from 3 panels this morning. Firstly, I welcome to the committee Rona Mackay, Community Council Member from Bembecula Community Council, Alison MacLeod, Society Secretary from Mid-Steeple Quarter, Debbie Herron, Development Manager from Forest Area Community Trust, Pauline Smith, Chief Executive from Connect Community Trust, and Philip Revelle, Community Board Member from Sustaining Dunbar. And we are going to move straight to questions. And witnesses, if you wish to respond or contribute to the discussion, please put an R in the chat box to indicate this. It may be that there are some questions that are not necessarily relevant to your experience, and what we're going to try to do is direct our questions initially to initial 1 or 2 people. If you do want to come in on the questions, you're welcome to. So I just want to start to say that by saying that we are in a privileged position to be overseeing the conclusion of the local government's review, which launched in 2017, and ensuring that its findings shape the upcoming local democracy bill and the community and community wealth building. And I'd like to begin asking, and I think this one actually is a general question for everyone, I'd like to hear about your understanding of your local communities. What are the challenges? We'd like to understand what's going on in your local communities. What are the challenges, strengths, and the roles each organization find in improving the outcomes for local governance review? And I'll begin. I just also want to say that I, for the record, I do know Debbie Herron. We live in the same town and have worked recently together on the response to COVID-19. So great to have you here, Debbie. So I'd like to begin with... Well, let's just begin with Rona, Alison, Debbie, then Pauline, and then Phil. Rona? Can't hear you.
Hello.
Hello. Welcome.
I live in Bembecula. And the chain of islands known as Uist. And starting off with the challenges, we have some huge challenges we face. We're one of the first communities that will be affected by climate change due to rising sea levels. Our islands are connected by causeways, and so any rise in sea levels is obviously going to affect us, and already is affecting us in terms of people getting to work during stormy weather and to school and to any other facilities they need. So we're tackling that. Our communities are trying to do their best to think their way around it, but it's a huge challenge. And to get our voice heard and actually get anyone to take an interest and to help us with that is a challenge too, being so remote from any decision-making areas. Other challenges we're facing just now is it's become critical, really, the services around mental health in US. We have huge problems, including suicide and alcoholism, which we don't have any services really to tackle them ourselves. So we're trying to look at ways ourselves that we can tackle isolation, and what can we do as a community to actually do something about the poor mental health. Another problem is housing, where a lot of our houses are getting bought up for second homes, and we're worried that we'll end up like the Isle of Skye, which is mainly full of second homes, and local people will get pushed out. So we're trying to we know that our young people want to live in Uist and they want to set up home here and have families. We currently have a majority of elderly population, which is a huge problem for us, and that's being exacerbated by young people not being able to find homes. So that's another issue that we're trying to tackle as a community at the moment. And fuel poverty as well is a huge issue here, where we know it's an issue, we've known it for years, and we've done the research ourselves to look at fuel poverty and what needs to be done to tackle hard-to-treat housing. But the change isn't happening, and we're a small population of a few thousand people. And to be able to tackle all these huge issues ourselves on our own is very difficult. And I don't think it's something that could be led only by statutory services. I think it's something we need support to be able to grow and lead in these issues ourselves and decide what needs to be done for them.
Thank you very much, Rona. And I just got a message that you did really well, because I heard that the question got cut off. So I'm just going to repeat it. We'd just like to get a sense of your local community, what the challenges are, what the strengths are, and the role of your organisation in trying to improve these outcomes. And the next person is Alison McLeod from Mid-Steeple Quarter.
Mid-Steeple Quarter is based in Dumfries, and it arose from extensive consultation work carried out by our sister organisation, Dove, over many years. They provided a space where it was safe to speak, where they spent a lot of time and looking at the big picture. The question was, this is our town, what do we do about it? So there was a mixture of this big picture thinking and discussion and hands-on work, volunteering work, which brought a lot of people in and got them engaged in the conversation who otherwise wouldn't have been done. So the issues that Dumfries and Dumfries Town Centre particularly is facing and was facing at that point was it's just pretty empty. There's nothing much happening there. Where all the buildings used to be occupied in the past by shops and the ground floor and even longer ago by people, quite a substantial population living in the town centre. It has now gone down to almost nobody living there at all. Lots of empty buildings and shops, empty shops, like shut empty for decades, not just recently. Really, the high street is particularly quiet, and it's not an attractive place, or it hasn't been an attractive place for new businesses to set up. And since the pandemic has got worse, with businesses like large chains closing there. So the discussion at the Stove kind of created a sense of ownership and empowerment, and the decision that as nobody else was going to do anything about the town centre, that it was up to the local people to do something about it. And out of that came Mid-Steeple Quarter, which is a separate organisation. And we have been working hard over the last 4 years. And we had identified a block of buildings. It's eight buildings in total, but these are very large buildings. They're deep. They're still in the medieval layout. And they all include shops in the ground floor and what has been accommodation on the two or three floors above that. And we are just about to start rebuilding the first of those buildings, which was the first one that came into ownership through a transfer from the council. And the idea is all about building a community there. There will be a substantial number of homes, so there'll be people living there. It'll bring the area to life, it'll mean that there'll be things going on in the evening, because there'll be people living in the town centre. At the moment, the town centre just completely shuts 5 o'clock, and it's like a ghost town. And in the the ground floors were going to have a business, but not just straightforward business, more community-based, local enterprises, social enterprises. We have our first tenants just engaged at the moment in restoring a building to, so that it's fit to use, and that is a community interest company, which involves a large number of small creative businesses who couldn't afford their own properties and have been selling online or at markets to have a place where they can permanently be selling their produce and the things that they make. And we also, the building that we're rebuilding is going to be a building that's going to provide a lot of support and opportunities to, again, to local small businesses. There'll be a co-working space, there'll be meeting spaces, there'll be a retail space, a very flexible building with all sorts of opportunities for support for businesses, for networking. And these will be all local small businesses, which at the moment are working from home or from premises that are not particularly suitable for them and things like that. So it's all about enabling enterprise in that area, but not the sort of enterprise that we've had in High Street in the past that has been owned by companies that don't have any connection with Dumfries themselves or don't feel responsible for community. It's all about benefit for the community in general, as well as for the small businesses.
Thank you, Alison. That's great. And if we can go on to Debbie, and if I can just encourage, it was great to hear the full detail or a little bit of the detail on Mid-Steeple Quarter, but we're looking at the kind of, the challenges and the strengths in relationship to the governance review. So I think if we can hear a bit about, where do you feel like there's blocks for you doing the things that you want to do in your community? So it's hearing a little bit about the local community. What are the challenges in the community? What are the strengths? What's the role of the organization? I'm just doing that because we've got 9 more questions to go through. So we'll be able to tease out a lot more as we go through them. Debbie, thank you.
Hello, thank you. Sorry, I lost the last few minutes of your conversation there. It cut out.
Did you hear? Okay, so I was just saying that if you can, we've got about 10 questions. Is that her cutting out again? No, okay. We've got about 10 questions to go through. So this is just giving the committee...
Hear anything at all.
You can't hear anything at all? No. Okay, so maybe we
can
should...
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Okay, so we're just going to suspend briefly to do technical check because apparently there's problems with various people on the Blue Jeans. Can you chat through? Okay, so now we'd like to hear from Debbie Herron from Forest Community Trust. Debbie, if you can give us an overview of your local community, what the challenges are, the strengths, and the role of Forest Area Community Trust in overcoming and improving the outcomes.
Sorry, you've gone again there. Sorry, Adriana, but I think I know what you want, so I'll try.
Give it a go, and I'm sure it'll be fine.
Yeah. Okay. So Forest Area Community Trust is a development trust. I'm part of the Development Trust Association Scotland Network. We work as the anchor organisation in the Forest area in partnership with a range of other organisations, development trusts, public agencies, etc. Our aim really is to make Forest a better place to live, work and visit, and to do that in partnership with others as much as we can. I think some of the things that were said just before there, we can echo that as well. But in addition, part of the problem that we've got is around connectivity, not just in the Forest area, but across Moray. The towns of Elgin and Forest and things are relatively well serviced by broadband and IT. But once you get a mile or two out of town, it can get extremely challenging for people to get connected. And when we run our outreach program of helping people, Forest Online, to help people get connected, that can be our main challenge. And I know that we get feedback from people that they can't get online in whatever way, shape or form, whether it's a dongle or whether it's connected through the landline. The other thing I think is around centralisation of NHS services. So for example, obviously for economies of scale, things happen in Elgin or wherever, but for some people or even Aberdeen, and that's a real access issue for people because public transport isn't great, or people can't afford to run a car if they live out somewhere that there's no bus route. So things like that, connectivity into services is and healthcare is a real challenge. And the other thing that is an issue is around communication with that, because for example, if they run something locally, say a vaccination program for flu jabs or something for children, there's a disconnect between what used to happen in the sense of people got their appointment letters from their local GP, they went along and it was fine. Now, because it's done centrally, people are getting appointment dates for when clinics aren't running, and there's confusion there for individuals, and that's happened quite a lot lately. So there is an issue around providing the services that people need locally, I think, is important. And that doesn't necessarily happen as well as it could. There's also, obviously, resources are tight. We have the situation where in Moray, Moray Council have released a lot of facilities, venues, buildings into community use. And we've successfully had a community asset transfer of Aurora's Town Hall, which has been great. However, there is a disconnect in communication within the local authority. So for example, they obviously wanted to release resources into the community, which we've done, but then there was proposals made to charge us for those venues. So on top of communities picking up the shortfall or the gaps that are in provision, they're also in some cases being expected to pay for that on top of that. And to be totally blunt, communities don't have resources to cover those sorts of payments into things. So again, there's a thing around joined up thinking, around connecting groups together, organisations, and actually getting support in such a way that we can work collectively and in partnership better. There are lots of other things, but I think that will do for a start.
Great, thank you very much for that. Yes, and I'm sure that the questions we ask ongoing will bring out more of that. So next up is, I've forgotten my list, Pauline Smith from Connect Community Trust. Pauline, would you like to tell us about your community?
Community Trust, and we're based in Greater Easter House in Glasgow. So I'm also part of DTA and the DTA Scotland movement. So I'm one of the directors on there. So we're part of 300 plus organisations across Scotland as a development trust. But specifically to do with Connect in Greater Easter House, we run something like 80 odd services per week that are 90% run by local people or employed or volunteered or on the board. They range from youth clubs to employment advice, training, educational work, school workshops, allotments, family clubs, income advice, the list goes on, but all run by local people and empowered by local people right the way through out of all of our services. So our strength, when you ask what our strength is, very much it's about local control and local people being in control of those services and them shaping and developing them right the way through from the ground up, right the way through to fruition and developing them as we go. The pressures and the problems that we face, you know, at the moment are Great Easter House, you know, has a lot of unemployment, a lot of low incomes. We've had health issues that we've had to be overcoming over the years. And all of this has been sort of accentuated with the COVID issues that we've all faced. But we definitely are looking sort of education, employment, mental health issues, low income. And for our organisation, it's about sustainability as well, do you know? So all the services that we were providing previously are now needed even more. So there's added pressure on our organisation and on local people actually to support each other. And I know later we're probably going to come on to the COVID thing, but the power of actually local people supporting each other throughout this period and wanting to do more. But I suppose the problem we face is that we've got hundreds of things that we want to do, but we need the support to be able to do them, do you know, and we want to move quickly and efficiently and listen to what the people have got. Their strength is definitely this people power behind us, the power of local people having their say. But we want to make sure it's reality, do you know, and that's also the strength of our organisations, is that we've been able to, you know, when people say they need something, we help them do it, do you know, so we help them along to actually make things reality in their own communities. We want to do more of that, and that's definitely one of our strengths, but also the challenges, which is where the local governance review has been very powerful in the sense of having those conversations with people. But what we don't want is, I suppose, false promises of, we want you to have your say, but then, and what do you want control of, but then not being able to take that forward. And I think the strength of all our organisations in the third sector is that we do make them reality. You know, we listen to what they are and we put them in charge of and lead on the developments that they want to see happen. I think, you know, when we're talking again about the strengths of our organisations, we've got probably about, you know, I think we've got 100 odd volunteers, staff, placements, etc., that are all local people. That's the strength of our organisation, you know, that we can bring the voices of those people actually to the table. And, yeah, you know, challenge, I suppose, decisions that are maybe being made without their say. And I think that's what we bring to the table. So I could go through the 80 odd different services and community control that we do. But I think certainly from the strength and challenges that we face is to do with sustainability and the financial implications of and pressures that we've now seen coming out of COVID, which we already had prior to COVID. They're just being accentuated now, and there's more people needing more support and more help.
Thank you very much for that. And Phil, would you like to tell us about your organisation, strengths, challenges for the community as well?
Thank you. Yes, I'll do my best. Yeah, I'm on the board of Sustaining Dunbar, which is a community development trust. I'm also convener of the Scottish Communities Climate Action Network, which is a network of over 200 groups across Scotland. So Sustaining Dunbar is it's part of a vibrant network of community-led organisations in Dunbar. We, I guess, have a particular focus on how we can face up to the nature and climate emergencies, and how we can use this as an opportunity to really transform our locality to ensure well-being for all in the flourishing environment. And I suppose our feeling is that, one of the key challenges we face, I mean, not just locally, obviously, but globally, is the climate and nature emergency. And the challenge there really is that we're coming into an unprecedented situation. And in order to really face up to that, we need to be able to tap into everybody's collective intelligence and local knowledge in order to come up with local solutions. And a key challenge we face at the moment is that there are no local well-facilitated forums where we can really tap into people's local knowledge and ideas and imagination in a creative way. Because, yeah, well, we don't really have any functional local democratic spaces where that can happen. In terms of more specific challenges locally, we're facing really a housing crisis locally. The house prices are ridiculous locally, and very few houses on the market. Even finding rented accommodation is extremely difficult, and rents are going through the roof. And this is connected really with a planning system which really disempowers people locally. There's a huge pressure from housing developers in our area who've got sort of options on local land to build lots of new housing. At the same time, no local people can access any land. There's lots of people who would like to be able to access land to set up their own housing co-ops, co-housing schemes, or self-build or whatever, but there's no chance of getting any land. And that relates as well to the lack of funding and resources. We really met through the COVID crisis, worked with 30 other local organisations to create a joint COVID recovery plan to think through what sort of future we wanted to work towards. And we've created a what next action plan, but now we have no funding to actually implement that plan. So that is a huge frustration, that lots of different local organizations waste a huge amount of time trying to chase different pots of funding. And it's a huge waste of time and resource. And then when we do get funding and then projects come to an end, then we lose a huge amount of expertise and knowledge when the funding comes to an end. Otherwise, yeah, that there's, because of the way that funding to local authorities has been cut over the recent years, that there's actually very little support from local authority. That the sort of community development workers that we used to get a lot of support from and work closely with are grossly under-resourced, and there's very little sort of community development work funded by the local authority. So yeah, that's probably enough for now, is it?
Great, thank you very much. Yes, so I'm going to go round everyone again with a second question, and this one can be a fairly brief answer, again, because we've got more questions than we don't have a lot of time. I wish we had a whole day to speak to you, because I think this is a really also a very, we try to select, you know, people, organizations representing from across the experience of Scotland. So we've got everyone, you know, Rona, you're in Benbecula, and then we've got Pauline in Easterhouse. So, you know, just great to hear the range of experiences. What I'd like to understand now, and I'll just go through the same order, is what your the level of involvement you had in the local government's review, your expectations when participating and communicating with the organisers, and also your understanding of the next steps. And this could be just quite brief, just so that we understand if you, you know, if you have had engagement and how it's gone. And we'll start with Rona.
I think I got most of it, but you cut off at the end there. So
give it a go.
I went round I can hear you now.
If you think you got most of it, that would be great. Just go ahead. Thank you.
Okay, so I canvassed as many people as possible before today in Uist, and people that are very involved in the third sector. Uist won the accolade of third sector police this year, and it's due to the huge number of people who are involved in the third sector. But most people said they hadn't heard of the local governance review, hadn't been involved, and weren't sure what it was. but they all wanted to contribute their opinions and their thoughts on it, and felt that they hadn't had an opportunity yet to take part in it. So it's difficult to say how to really answer that question, more than just saying that, you know, in the islands, probably as a whole, I'm not sure that many people were aware of it, that it was happening, or were able to contribute to it yet. But there is certainly a lot of people who do want to contribute and want to have their views put across, and gave me those views to put across on their behalf today.
That was great, thank you. I mean, the fact that what your response is very helpful for the committee to hear, that people don't even know what the local governance review is. That's really very good. So I'm going to ask the question again, because I hear that my mic may not have been working and it was not so clear. So what we'd like to hear is what your is about involvement in the local government review. If you were involved, what your expectations when participating were, and the communication with the organisers, and also your understanding of what the next steps are to be. And so now, Alison.
As I understand it, Mid-Staple Quarter were not involved directly in the local government review, but we're quite a young organisation. But I understand that the Stove were, that's surely the ideal place for that sort of discussion to be carried out, because they engage so effectively. But I'm afraid I wasn't involved in it, so I can't really comment on how that went.
Okay, thank you. Debbie?
But the Democracy Matters consultation process, we promoted it, but my understanding is that not many people engaged with it. And when I've asked around, I haven't had very much in the way of response.
Okay, thank you. And Pauline?
Hi. My experience is a wee bit different. So I've known about it and been involved in it through Development Trust Association Board, but also locally in our community. So when the conversation started, we had gala days and events like we usually do anyway, but made the Democracy Matter conversation part of that. So there was questionnaires and everything that went through all of our events and all our activities. We had meetings with our board, volunteers. We also met with housing and other community organisations locally as well to actually talk about what Democracy Matter meant. And there was a submission between all of those organisations individually, excuse me, and also as a partnership in Greater Easter House as well, that fed into the whole conversation. So we all submitted papers into that. Alison McKinley and I think Brian has come out as well, met with our local community groups. So there was local events that took place with that as well. And then from a wider sort of Development Trust point of view, there was also, you know, a submission from DTA Scotland on behalf of the members as well. So I've maybe got a different sort of viewpoint, you know, because we were very heavily involved. We also attended some of the roadshow events and things like that the government has had and the department has had. I think as far as sort of next steps are concerned, when you're asking about next steps, the only thing that's, I suppose, been disappointing up to now is it's stalled, but COVID has a lot to do with that, and we're aware of that. So I think, you know, we'd community were extremely, and other organisations and the partnership in Easter House was very much sort of on board with where this could go and what we could do, and, you know, control the power, you know, like all of those conversations being had. So we're quite excited about it. And I think it's just sort of fallen flat at the moment, but that's a lot to do with COVID. And I think for us, we just want to see that next step taken, you know. So for all those conversations and all that feedback that's been given by communities to actually try and put that in place. And I think my understanding is it's part of the programme for government, you know, so it has been put on the table to try and push this forward. So hopefully that's what we're talking about today, obviously. So, we are just keen to see it move forward and quickly, if it can.
Great. Thank you, Pauline. And Phil?
SCAN did run an event for our members almost exactly 3 years ago, I think, as part of the Democracy Matters consultation, and our members got very excited by it at the time and came forward with lots of proposals for how democracy must be much more local and have much have many more resources and powers at the local level. Since then, yeah, personally, I've sort of been slightly kept abreast of where it's at through my involvement with the Scottish Community Alliance. But I think if you asked anybody locally in Dunbar, that they wouldn't have a clue what you're talking about. So, yeah, I think that's it, really.
Okay, thank you very much. That's very interesting to get that perspective from all of you. I'm going to move over to questions that are going to be picked up by Paul McClellan. Paul.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. And can I refer everyone to my register of interests? I'm still a councillor on East Lothian Council. And also to declare that I know Philip Revel and was previously involved with Sustaining Dunbar. So it's good to see Philip here and others here. Just to kind of expand on the questions that the Convener mentioned there, and it's really just talking around about communities' experience, your community's experience of working with local authorities and other local bodies and how your relationships can be improved. And I'll come across to... I'll take the initiative here. I'll ask Philip first of all.
Thank you, Paul. Well, a mixed bag, I think you could say. In the past, we've had very good relationships with East Lothian Council and a lot of support with particular projects, but a lot depends on developing a relationship with a particular officer, and then there's a challenge when officers move on and there's reorganisation and you have to re-establish that relationship from scratch. We had a lot of support when we're setting up the zero waste reuse hub, for example, and intercepting waste from going to landfill and that sort of thing. But on other projects, we've had much less support in trying to get find premises to have a co-working space locally, for example. I think that there's a real issue around lack of resource going into community development work locally.
Philip, just a supplementary on that, and it'll be the kind of same question for everybody else, is, you know, whether you think local people want to be more involved in decisions impacting their communities. Is there evidence for that, and has COVID changed that one way or another?
Well, I think there's no doubt that people would like to be, but it's difficult to answer that in a way, because I think people have felt so disconnected and disempowered for so long that actually it's going to be quite a challenge for them to develop a real sense of agency. And I think that's particularly the case around the planning system, where people feel that the system really is rigged in favour of large developers and really don't feel any agency to affect decisions. And that relates to the community council as well. I think actually we expend a huge amount of effort commenting on planning applications and then often feel ignored.
Philip, thank you for that. Can I come on to Pauline and just ask the same question, just around about your experience with your local authority and other bodies, and whether you think your own local community wants to get more involved, and you know whether COVID has changed that?
Yeah, there's mixed relationships. I think probably everyone has mixed relationships with the councils, but certainly locally we have some really good, active councillors that listen when we need action. They're there to listen, and they seem to get things done. But they do get things done. But I think through all of this process, we've always put it over. It's about helping councillors, and it's about helping the council. Do you know, this isn't about taking power away from individuals or anyone. It's literally about we can help with the power of people that we've got that are seeing us day to day on a day to day basis. That we can help do that job. Help improve the area and potentially save the council money as well, you know, like, you know, but our relationships are good. I would say, you know, that there's, for instance, the Northeast sector has one representative for the voluntary sector on it, which is supposed to be a voice for the whole voluntary sector, and they're supposed to represent 200 odd organisations in an area. It's impossible. So the way things in the council are, the different structures are laid out, they're called community planning, but you know, the actual voluntary sector isn't as heavily represented, I would say, within these current structures to allow for the voices to get through. I think on a local basis, when we're talking about what local people they want involved, they absolutely do. You know, proof of all of our services being run by local people. They want involved in delivery and they want involved in having a say about what happens to them and their community. But we need, again, the powers to be able to do that more structured, I suppose, and more locally. Because, you know, even the decision making, you know, if you want, I don't know, a grass cut or something within our, one of the allergies we always use is the community litter picks. You know, we had to apply for funding within the council to actually get the money to do the equipment for litter picks, you know, and we could have done that locally. Do you know, like if there's local budgets and local control in there, we could have quickly and efficiently done these things. Yes, there's a desire for it, whether it's a formal structure all the time, not necessarily, but if you ask locally, do people know what community planning is, they'd probably say no. But actually, if you say what they do know is the youth group, they know the Connect, they know the housing association, they know all of these structures and these people that are engaged with. And I think that's going to need to strengthen on the local basis.
Thanks,
Paula. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, thank you very much. Debbie and then Alison and then Rona, it's just the same question, if it's possible.
Can you just repeat the question quickly?
Yeah, just your experience of your community, your experience in your community group of working with local authorities and other public bodies, and whether you think your own local community has an appetite to get for more empowerment and be more involved in decisions, and whether that's changed since COVID.
I would say yes, our community definitely wants to be involved in decision making, and we have a very vibrant community with over 200 different sized groups and things locally. When the COVID pandemic hit, we worked very well together and collectively, and were very fast to respond. There was a lot of volunteers who got up there and did things. The local authority was slower because obviously it's bigger and it's got bureaucracy to deal with. I would say the same as the others, that it's mixed. I think with some officers and some departments like the community support unit, we've had excellent support and excellent relationships. Other departments, maybe not so. I think there is an issue about communication between departments in the local authority. So if one department's doing something, another department can do something directly opposite to that. So I think that it is mixed. I would say that we were very keen to work more in partnership, and not just us, but other organisations locally. There is an element around people are very disenfranchised with the local authority. They just feel not heard. They feel that no matter what they want, they don't get it. They don't see change. They don't see any improvement. That potentially is fair in some ways, but not necessarily in others. So I think there is an appetite to work closer together and to do more. But again, there is an element around communication and for people to understand why decisions have been made and to make decisions more collectively, which are not happening at the moment. Okay.
Debbie, thank you for that. Alison and then Rona, just the same thing, same question.
Okay. We've been dealing with buildings really rather than dealing with, you know, running events and things like that, because our buildings are only just coming into use. So our work with the council has been actually fairly straightforward. A lot of it, you know, getting planning permission and things like that. And our chief exec is a planning professional, so he already had these links from his previous work. That has gone fairly straightforwardly, I think. We had the first building that Whitstaple Quarter owned was an asset transfer from the council, which these things never happen fast, but I don't think there were any major problems there. We've had some funding for rebuilding work. And this is our connections are mainly with council employees. We haven't had real interest from councillors, particularly. We don't hear a lot from them. I mean, we don't hear anything negative from them, but we don't have strong connections with our local councillors, I wouldn't say. One thing that we've been looking at is there's an aquifer under the Priestown Centre, which we're potentially going to access to provide the heat for a district heating scheme for our buildings and potentially more buildings. And we have progressed this to the point where we've got funding in place to actually drill a borehole to investigate the potential. So that's taken quite some time to get to that point. The council have explored this in the past, not to that stage, but to an earlier stage, and then done nothing more with it. And now that we're more actively exploring it, I think it's just coincidence, possibly, but they are also looking at it again as something that they might look at. So I don't know how that's going to work out. That's just recently that's arisen, that they're also looking at the idea of using this aquifer for heat for the for town centre buildings. So we need to really have some kind of discussion with them about, you know, how this is going to work out.
Thanks, Alison. Rona, just do yourself, just briefly, if you could come in that one.
It is a mixed bag as well for us. Personally, and I think a lot of people find that the local councillors are really easy to access and to talk to. They're well known in the community. One of them set up and ran Resilient Eurist, which was really driving force between our keeping our community going during the pandemic. It's a mixed bag, though. A lot of major decisions can be made in Stornoway, which is a long way from where we live. It's a ferry ride for us, and it's two ferry rides for people from Barra to get to the council's building in Stornoway, and decisions can be made there without any consultation with the communities in the other islands. One example in particular is in Barra, where they decided to knock down some existing buildings the community were using and set up a completely entirely new kind of hub there, and the community were against some of the plans and very vocal about it. And one woman described to me how she just couldn't get to speak to anybody who made the decisions in Stornoway, and she said the only way that she was going to be able to speak to them was to drive all the way up and take two ferries and travel for an entire day just to go and get her point made. And so it is a very mixed bag. And on the other hand, you know, our councillors are very easy to get hold of. But one major problem I would say that is that our council is 100% male councillors. And if you look across Scotland, it's 29% male councillors. So the female voice and representation and ability to get their voice heard in the Western Isles is, you know, we do most of the care at home and that sort of thing. Childcare, there's very little voice, nothing ever happens in that. And I'm guessing that's because we have 100% male councillors and women don't feel that they have that access to power and decision making at all.
Okay. Well, no, thanks. Thanks all.
I'm going to move on to questions from Megan. Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Before I ask my question this morning, like Paul, I would like to declare an interest as I am a serving councillor in North Lanarkshire. And my question to the panel today relates to the findings of the 2019 Scottish Household Survey, because it found that across Scotland only 18% of people feel that they can influence decisions affecting their local area, and it's kind of what Rona was talking about just there. So I'd like to ask the panel, why do they think that this is so low, and what are the barriers? And if I can just squeeze it in just very quickly, if they think that participatory budgeting is the key to getting more people involved and decisions that influence their community. And if I could start with Rona, please.
Yeah, so our local paper recently talked to women across Eust about why they didn't go for councillor and why they didn't take part in the decision making or feel that they should. And they said it came back that a lot of it was down to distance. They felt that having to spend time travelling to Stornoway for meetings and so on was just not something they could do while looking after their own children. But that can't only be the issue, because then there aren't any female Stornoway councillors either. So there must be other things that are part here. And some of it is evening meetings. A lot of the councillors have to commit to huge numbers of evening meetings, which isn't good if you're if you do have children or parents to care for. Also, women felt that they don't feel they can go into a room and have their voice heard. They're worried that they'll, you know, going into a room which is absolutely full of male people making decisions, to actually have the confidence for your own voice to be heard and to say what you think, and will you actually be taken seriously? It's again a problem for young people. Recently, we've started a project doing a local energy plan for Eust, and we're trying to make it as inclusive as possible. And we were talking to one young person about how to include them in it, because every meeting he goes to, he stays completely silent in the meetings. And he said that he felt that meetings aren't inclusive because for him, they're quite scary. They're terrifying times where to say what you think and to have your voice heard, you don't know if other people will laugh at you or whether they won't take you seriously. And so decision making isn't inclusive really for young people either. So I think a lot more has to be done to look at the different mechanisms and structures and way that decisions making is made. So it's not always in a formal format in which people might not feel comfortable giving out their minority view.
Thank you, Rona. And if I could move to Pauline, please. And I'm conscious of time, convener. So Pauline, and then if there's any other comments, thank you.
Hi there. So I agree with what Rona was saying there regarding sort of the it feeling intimidating within Glasgow. Obviously, all the meetings take place in chambers, you know, so it's about going, making an effort to go into the chambers, and the chambers building itself is intimidating even to walk into it, you know, so it doesn't feel as inclusive in that sense, and, you know, that your voice is going to be heard there because it's intimidating. So what I would say is, you know, I've not seen the survey itself, but certainly when you ask locally again, though, you know, do people have control over the services and are they being heard within Connect and various other development trusts? I think people would say yes. So, you know, it's again how that question is structured. Do they feel that they have local decision making powers or control over what they do? I think yes, they would say yes within local structures that we have within Connect and within the local area, where if you're interested in youth, for instance, we've got a mini subgroup for youth stuff, we've got an elderly subgroup, we've got people with disability services, we've got growings, you've got all these little subgroups that people will dip in and dip out of because they're not as formal structures like that, but they're also things that they're interested in. So sometimes going to a big meeting where it's got an agenda of 50 items, you know, like, not interested in all of that, they're interested because they've got a kid, they've got a granny, they've got a something, you know. So that's what, you know, that's why local structures work very good, and they're very powerful in that sense as well. I think it's what you said about PB. I don't have any experience myself with PB, but I maybe need to go to someone else on that one.
Thank you.
Okay, and Philip and then Debbie would also like to come in on this.
Thank you. Yeah, no, just to say, really, I think we urgently need to create different sort of spaces where we can actually have properly sort of deliberative conversations, where we can bring in different perspectives and potentially conflicting opinions and creatively consider them in a meaningful and creative way. So we urgently need those spaces and also then the skills to actually convene and facilitate such spaces where everybody's voice can be heard. That seems absolutely crucial to me. And potentially, I think we need to be prepared to actually pay people for their time in participating in those sort of spaces, because at the moment, it's really a self-selecting group who can participate, who have the time to do so, and can spare that time. And in terms of participatory budgeting, I don't actually have any direct experience, but I think we originally need to be able to put in resources at grassroots level. And I think if we did have meaningful resource and investment coming in at level, then that is and developed good participatory budgeting ways of allocating that funding, then that could be a really good way of really engaging many more people in the conversation about local priorities.
Thank you.
And Debbie.
So a couple of things. One around engaging with meetings and things. Sometimes things are perceived as tick box exercises. So if you're in a meeting, things go through so fast in general. Obviously, people have got limited time, but there's no opportunity for anybody to have a say, because then and like voted on or whatever very quickly. So there isn't any opportunity to ask questions or get clarity on things before decisions are made. I think that in local authorities need to go where the people are rather than expecting people to come to them. So our civic centre is Elgin, which is great, but not everybody can get there. So there needs to be ways that people can come and, you know, they go out to communities rather than in, and maybe circulate things around. And Zoom's good, or working online, because that does give more people an opportunity to participate if their internet's good. Re-participatory budgeting. I've got a little bit of experience with that. There's been three or four different PB sessions happened across Moray. One of the money for Moray is a voluntary panel. They secured funding through Moray Council, through the Scottish Government, to do some PB, and I think that worked really, really well. It was transparent, everybody voted, it was explained extremely clearly, but it is quite resource and time heavy to get people into understanding what the process is. There have been several other PB things happen in Moray, and I don't think they've been as well communicated. And I think how PB works gets lost in translation, because it is a particular system, it does work, but if people don't understand it, they'll move it to how they want their agenda to be, and that has happened in the past. So that creates frustration, and people don't like what happened. But if it's transparent and it's open, and people have had training in how to do it, it works.
Great, thank you, Debbie and Alison.
Yes, we haven't really had much to do with councillors at all. I'm not sure if what the reason is for that. Maybe more that we're at the acquisition and rebuilding stage rather than, you know, running activities or having activity in our buildings. We have a good relationship with some MSPs, and we have a very close relationship with the community council that serves the centre of the town. That's a very important relationship, and we have a representative of that community council on our board. So that's really important for building the sense of community. So we put a lot of effort into having good communications with them. Participatory budgeting, no, we haven't been involved in that. We're not delivering services at the moment, so it probably didn't apply very well to Municipal Quarter. We're also looking for quite big sums of money rather than small plots, usually.
Great.
Thank you,
Alison. Okay, we're going to move on to a question from Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you. Oh, do I need to press the button? I'm on. Sorry, I couldn't see the light. Good morning. Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. And before I ask my question, I'm just going to declare the interest that I am still a serving councillor in East Ayrshire Council. In my own council area, communities are supported to create their own community-led action plan where they need a minimum of a 40% return from every single household within their community for that to be a sovereign document. That then has representation in community planning and is also the basis for local place plans. Can I ask how your own organisations ensure that all voices are heard within their communities, not just for the people that have confidence, experience and the resources to come forward? Sometimes it's, you know, the usual faces around the same tables. And can I start perhaps with Pauline and then go to Rona, if that's possible? Thank you.
I have probably sort of preempted this question by answering it a couple of times through the question. So I think where we come from is with the to ensure voices are heard, you know, physically being involved in actually delivering the services, walking through the door, just voicing their opinion. They have lots of subgroups that I touched on in the previous question there, where people, you know, people on our board all have a specific interest. So whether they got involved with because of young people, whether it was care, whether it was a child with disability, whether it was employment, they all have their different reasons for getting involved. So there's a wide array of sort of skills and also knowledge and personal experiences and everything that come onto the board. But that also is from the local people. You know, one of our board members is a local lollipop woman, you know, so they basically, you know, they're talking to people on a continuous basis of finding out what do they need. So we have our formal structures with subgroups, but we also have the informal, just have a chat, we do community brunch, lunch and dinner, you know, all of this sort of social aspects of just getting together and having a chat about what finding out what it is. And we also have formal sort of volunteer programmes, etc. You know, again, all of those voices are being heard constantly through the day-to-day activities and services that we're running. So we make sure that isn't the same old faces. I think when we come back to that confidence of getting into a community planning board meeting in Glasgow City Chambers. You know, that's sometimes where it's the same faces, because it's that confidence level. So we try to make sure that we've got the structure in-house on a local level to make sure that those voices are being heard and as wide array of voices as possible. So it all comes through our service delivery though on a day-to-day basis. It doesn't always have to be a formal structure.
Thanks very much, Pauline. And I'm aware that maybe some people didn't hear the question, so I'll just repeat the last bit of it. And I would like to hear from Rona, and it's about how, you know, the community council there can make sure that all the voices in the community are heard, and it's not just the same people around the table all the time. So it's about that, the wider recognition of every voice in your community. And Rona, if you could maybe come in on that. And then if anybody else wants to, they put an R in the chat.
Yeah, as I said before, we're putting together a youth local energy plan. So it's not really through the community council, but it's something we're doing in as a wider community thing across several third sector organisations. And what we're going to do is we're going to have the usual workshops to get, which will be open to anyone who wants to attend, and we'll geographically spread those out across Uist. But we're very aware that that's just going to give us the same enthusiastic voices who attend most consultations. We still want to hear from them what they think and what changes they would like to see in energy in Uist. But this time we're going to hold some separate workshops, which are going to be very different. So one of them will be aimed at young people, and I think the second one will be aimed at vulnerable people, and the third one perhaps the elderly, or people with dementia or learning difficulties. So our idea is to actually get out there and find the groups that we haven't managed to ever consult with in the past, and look at different ways of consulting with them. So some feedback we've had is that people don't like meetings, they don't want to have their voice heard, or they'd rather work through a different way. So maybe through more arts work, or maybe just in small conversations and groups. So we're going to be as flexible as we can to allow people to contribute in every way, any way that they feel comfortable, and see how it goes, and try and see if we can get some very different opinions this time instead of the usual enthusiastic retired voices that we so often hear from.
Thanks very much for that, Rona. Convener, I don't know if anybody else has Sanaa in the chat.
Yeah, so we'd like to, Debbie would like to come in, and Alison.
Right. So we have the community councils locally. We also have our development trust. We have the area forum, and we are looking, pre-COVID we did this, and we're looking to do it again, some collaborative events so that we all share information, and we also invite as many people as possible to come. They usually are very, very, very popular.
Sorry, Debbie, we've lost the audio for you. She probably can't hear me.
We also actively go out to places like schools or daycare centres or whatever, and have chats and ask questions there as well. We're open to having people come in and have a chat with us. Online surveys work really, really well. We have incredibly good report returns for those. And then we try and capture more detailed information from individuals with self-selecting focus groups. So that's kind of how we get out there as much as we can with info.
Thank you. And Alison?
We make community engagement a high priority, because partly because we're in a town, we're covering quite a big population. We've potentially got around 40,000 in the area that we're covering. So not easy to engage with a population that size. So we have a community engagement officer who works for us 3 days a week. And we also have 2 days a week on comms, social media, etc. And that's a big part of our resource. We've got a small staff team. So that's around 30% of our staff team working in communications. So we have we just use whichever way we can to communicate. It's difficult when we're at the stage where we're kind of at the empty building stage. We own 5 buildings. one of which was demolished, and we're only just getting a couple of the other buildings underway with activity in them, which is a tenant's rather than ours. We're using other spaces for what we call meantime use, so making them available to all sorts of people and using them ourselves, which is allowing people to go into the buildings and see what's going on there and have discussions. We regularly, during non-COVID times anyway, have events that people can attend, and where we provide a lot of information, and we're there in person to speak to them about what we're doing, what our plans are, and to listen to what they've got to say about that. Ensuring all voices are heard. I think we've had a really good start in that because of the really good groundwork in the stove, getting this all set up. Designing it all, planning it all to start with, as the answer to what was the problem for Dumfries Town Centre problem. And that included having a wide range of ways where people could get involved, including volunteering on a very practical basis, tidying up the town centre, cleaning buildings. Recently that started again, and we've been working on a small plot of land behind one of our buildings, which is going to turn into a green space that people can access, people living and using the building can access. So generally we just encourage people to come into the buildings and talk to us, and our CEO is now based there and is very available for anybody that wants to meet with them.
Thank you, Alison, and we're going to move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to everyone on the panel today. Could I ask what your understanding is of community wealth building, and particularly your views on the roles of what are being called anchor organisations, for example, as local housing associations, hospitals, colleges and universities? And I'll maybe start with Alison, because I think you kind of outlined how your organisation have maybe benefited early on from potential organisations supporting your establishment. So I'll maybe start with yourself, Alison, then, if anyone wants to put an R in the chat.
Yes, we've not been. I suppose we are talking about community wealth building, and where the buildings are, the building community in them. We're building a community that's not there at the moment. We haven't talked about it being wealth, but I suppose it is. It's local. It's local wealth. It's not Debenhams and Marks and Spencers and the profits going to shareholders who don't live in Dumfries. It's about what's available locally, making the most of it. There's a lot of attributes to Dumfries and Galloway that don't receive that we don't make of as much of as we should. I mean, it's an intensely creative place. There's just so much going on, but not really an opportunity for people to make a living out of it, or not a proper living out of it, and that's what we want to grow. There's also very good local food and drink. Again, it's just allowing us to make best of the assets that we have in the area by providing these buildings for small businesses and entrepreneurs working on growing, making, designing, using all their skills, and because they'll be sharing buildings, or that this is a place they can visit, maybe to work part-time, it'll allow networks to build up where small businesses are working together, and that will be a strength which they'll each benefit from, and the town will benefit from. And also about building this community that's going to live in these buildings. We are talking about, we're talking to the university, which is based, it's partially based in the Crichton campus, but they don't have any student accommodation, and they're interested in using some of the upper stories of our building for student flats, which will bring young life to the town centre, and We're also talking about potential housing that's suitable for elderly people, which might also include something along the model of that you see used in Holland and other places, where younger people can earn part of their accommodation costs by helping provide care for elderly tenants. And that is it can create a really good, healthy relationship between the two age groups. So we're open to all sorts of things that are innovative and inclusive and build community where there really hasn't been one for 40 years. And to kind of have a much more local economy where we make the most of all the many things we have in this resources we have in this area, both in terms of human resources and abilities and natural resources.
Thank you. Was there anyone else who'd asked to come forward? From what we've heard this morning, it sounds like a lot of the work which has been undertaken is quite organic. And so I wanted to ask, in terms of the roles of community council specifically, what in your opinion did you think should be improved to look at how their role can be strengthened or changed? And I suppose I should maybe start with Rona, as you're on the community council, and then move round.
Quite a bit of that question. I think they cut off at the beginning.
Sorry, it was just to ask specifically, Rona, in terms of community councils, how you think your role could be strengthened or changed.
I don't think we can hear at
all. Okay, so maybe what we'll do is we can put these in a letter. So I don't know if you can hear me, but I think we've kind of come to the end of our time anyway. What we will do is we've got a few other questions and maybe some of you missed out because of the technology. So we'll put the questions in a letter to you and you can respond that way. And also, you know, use that as an opportunity to let us know anything else that we may not have been able to cover this morning. But thank you very much for being with us. So thanks very much for being with us this morning. It was very good to hear a range of perspectives and clearly even, you know, from a very urban context to a very rural and island context, some of the issues are the same. And, you know, it's been very good to get your sense so that we've got a sense of how this local government governance review is going. So thanks for joining us this morning. And now we're going to suspend to allow a changeover for witnesses and have a wee pause. And we're going to start back at 10:20. Is that correct? 10:20. Welcome back. We'll continue our consideration of the Scottish Government Local Governance Review by taking evidence from representatives from COSLA. And I welcome Councillor Alison Evanson, who is the President of COSLA. Hello, Alison. And Simon Cameron, who's the Chief Officer of the Employers Team. So, yeah, welcome to the committee this morning, and we will move straight to questions. And if you wish to respond or contribute to the discussion and we haven't called you in, you can put an R in the chat box. And some of my committee colleagues are joining us virtually as well. So I'm just going to get started with, I'd be interested to get an update from you on the progress of the governance review from since May's elections. And also in previously the committee heard from COSLA about the principles that COSLA would like to see shaping the new fiscal framework. And we're just interested to know if you are now in a position to describe how it would actually work in practice.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting us along to speak today.
Hang on a minute,
today.
Alison, your volume is quite low. We're just going to... Sorry, is that on our end? Okay, let's try again. Alison.
Yeah, thank you very much for inviting us along to talk this morning. And I'm really glad there that you spoke about the local governance review, because I was quite concerned earlier that the word government was being brought in. And obviously, the whole local governance review has been about the reform of all public sector in order to improve outcomes for people across our communities. And I think that word governance is really important as part of that. Now, obviously, before the election, there was very close work between the joint owners of the local governance review, which are the Scottish Government and local government, and we shared the governance of the review. And that focused on three empowerments being needed to be taken forward concurrently: fiscal empowerment, as you've mentioned, functional empowerment, and community empowerment. And we got to the stage of agreeing that they would be taken forward, because by doing so, we'd be able to improve outcomes for citizens across our communities. During the months of COVID, obviously everybody's attention was necessarily elsewhere. And so there was agreed not to be progress with the local governance review at that process. But during COVID, we've also seen through many communities right across Scotland, many examples of what could be achieved in terms of outcomes if the local governance review principles were put into practice, and if people locally were empowered and trusted to deliver for their local communities. So COVID itself showed us what could happen, even though it wasn't happening. Since May's election, we have still been on hold with the development of the local governance review. Various councils across Scotland stand ready with their community partners and supported very much by COSLA to work on pilots which have been written up, which are ready to go, and which need to be given that final go-ahead to be able to demonstrate in the communities how a collaborative, partnership-based approach could really make a difference to improving outcomes for everybody across the communities. These pilots stand ready, as I've said. I think it was clear from earlier contributors this morning that what's really important is resources to make things happen. Things can't happen unless they're resourced. And obviously we're at the stage of needing to have the go-ahead for these pilots so that they can be progressed and that we can see the difference they can make across communities. And as I've said, we stand ready to support the partners involved in these projects to move ahead. As in terms of the fiscal framework, you also asked about, convener, the fiscal framework, as we've talked before about the importance of that for local government. I think, again, many of the contributors earlier talked about areas where they feel the councils aren't working at the moment. And I would argue very strongly that the reason councils aren't working in some of those areas that the contributors really want them to work is because councils aren't fiscally empowered to do so. That fiscal empowerment has not been put into operation. So councils have very little control over their funding. There's too much money that's still ring fenced. There's too much comes in small pots of money throughout the year, too much that comes with increasingly difficult and onerous admin reporting requirements, which make it very difficult to do work as well. And obviously within all that, the local has been what's had to give. And fiscal framework moving forward needs to be able to respond to local councils, local areas, local democracy and local empowerment to enable that work to be done at a local level so that multi-year funding is available, that councils and their partners can raise their own money locally, that things like participatory budgeting can be looked at in a really positive way at the local level as well. So our priorities for the fiscal framework remain the same, and we continue to seek your support as a committee that the fiscal framework and with it the fiscal empowerment that would bring are delivered to improve local outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you for that. And we're going to move on with a question from Mark Griffin, who's joining us virtually. Mark.
Thanks, Camina. I just wanted to ask, we've previously heard from yourselves, Councillor Everson and Cosla, about the principles that you would like to see shape the new fiscal framework. Just to ask if you are now in a position to describe how it would work in practice.
Thank you very much for your question, Mark. I mean, I think the things I briefly outlined in the last answer are about that as well. Now, the fiscal framework needs to be based, first of all, on a parity of esteem, a sense of working together, and understanding the shared outcomes required from it. Because as we look at recovery, and as we look towards moving forward for various kinds of renewal in terms of both economic and social, it is essential that Scottish Government and local government work in partnership on that, and that we are able to work and collaborate with other areas of the public sector at a local level where it is appropriate to do so as well. And the fiscal framework has to underpin that. Now, work is still ongoing on that, about how we will move forward, but multi-year funding is a crucial aspect of it. Councils being free to raise their own income in appropriate ways to their local area and their local community. We've talked about various forms of discretionary local taxation. We've had various examples of that, but we need to let councils fly with what's appropriate for their particular areas as well. We need to have certainty on the financial settlement as well, so that there can be long-term strategic planning. I think there's agreement across the piece that preventative work is essential. You know, we've seen many pressures on health and social care services recently, for example. You know, a lot of that could be addressed through preventative work going on across our communities, with everybody working together, public sector, third sector, our local councils as well. But that requires the ability to have a certainty of strategic planning. Financially, it requires a certainty of the money coming in, and that needs to happen without the ring fencing, which increases centralisation, without increasing that crucial principle of subsidiarity. And I think it comes down to it, you know, that any fiscal framework that's going to be developed has to have the element of trust in it. Now, if we're all working to the same outcomes, if we're all working to deliver the same things for our communities, if we are all really engaged in supporting the local, then that trust should come into it so that councils can use that fiscal framework to deliver with their local communities for their local communities.
Thank you for
and
that.
That's and, up to funding.
Go on, Mark.
Sorry, I was just saying that certainty of funding is critical then, and the UK government have recently published the multi-year spending review, and I know that is something that cause I want to see the Scottish government deliver too. So following on from the UK government's announcement on that multi-year spending review. What discussions, early as it might be, have you had with Scottish Government on confirming whether COSLA or local authorities would receive multi-year settlements to give that ability and certainty to plan?
Discussions are ongoing. We had a commitment a long while ago now for a fiscal framework to be developed in Scotland. It hasn't yet been developed. We want to see it developing as quickly as possible. And as I've said, the work is ongoing, but we would appreciate the committee's support to ensure that work done is done on a timely basis and that the principles, as I've talked about, are developed, in particular that multi-year funding to allow strategic planning and that preventative work, which is on everyone's agenda, to allow that to happen with our local communities. And obviously, although the work is ongoing, anything the committee can do to help us hasten that along would be very welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to kind of come back briefly on that, Alison, and ask how confident do you feel? How much confidence do you have that you will receive multi-year settlements from the Scottish Government from now on?
So I didn't hear most of that question. I just heard the last bit about how confident are we that we'll receive it. At the moment, all I can say is the work is ongoing and that we want that to be developed. And obviously, as Mark Griffin implied, it depends as well on the UK government and the funding that the Scottish government is getting on. You know, there's a cycle here that has to be developed. But as part of that work, I think if we share our outcomes, you know, if we really do share the outcomes of recovery, and I believe we do, and if we want to see that social renewal and economic renewal, and I believe we all do, I mean, I think there's shared belief in that one. I think there should also be the understanding that we need to make the money in the right places to make that happen. And again, that comes back to the comment I made on trust. So it has not yet been promised to us, but if we work together on these processes that we want to do, and we are working together, then I think it's really important that it is delivered. And again, the committee adding its voice to that would be very helpful.
Thank you for that. And I'm going to move to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to Councillor Everson and Mr Cameron. Thank you for joining us today. Could I ask, what's COSLA's understanding of the timetable for the future local governance review work? And do you think this is going to be impacted by next year's local government elections?
Thank you. We obviously have pilot projects that are ready to be delivered across our communities. They obviously involve a far greater range of people than our councils. That's the point, isn't it? It's the partnership work, that functional empowerment coming through as well, working involving other people. So if they get started and are able to progress, that should be able to continue. I think the important bit is the resourcing for them. As we've heard, you know, things don't happen without resources. Community empowerment is not something that won't happen by sitting here and saying we believe community empowerment is essential. We believe that functional empowerment is essential. These things need to be resourced and supported to develop, and that's something we need to do. But I'll pass on to Simon now to comment on the detail of how things are progressing. Simon.
Thank you, Councillor Everson, and thank you for the question. I think with regards to timeframes that we've got, obviously we are working proactively with our colleagues in government to re-establish the joint political oversight that we've got for the local governance review. Clearly the election is looming large in terms of it happening in May. However, that doesn't stop us continuing to progress the work that we can do locally. And as Councillor Everson has said, I think the strong commitment from both ourselves and government to see the governance review continue, indeed to work towards a local democracy bill that does strengthen local democracy across Scotland and takes an asymmetric approach across the country, and working on the fiscal empowerment that Councillor Everson has outlined, which we actively have a special interest group working on just now and engaging with colleagues in the local government finance section of government, then that is work that we can progress at pace. obviously it's got to be aligned with the recovery work that is ongoing just now. We want to see those intertwined, and we welcome the opportunity to put in place a firm timescale for taking the work forward.
Thank you for that. And looking at the two key bills which the government have brought forward in the programme for government, both the Local Democracy Bill and also the Community Wealth Building Bill, what would COSLA like to see within those, and what sort of discussions have you had? And from what you've put out previously with regards to the National Care Service, do you think there's an undermining of that potential opportunity for local democracy to be given more powers, if we're seeing under the European Charter, for example, the discussions we've had to recognise the role of local government, but then a National Care Service which would centralise some of that?
Thank you very much. Again, that's a very, very big question involving lots of aspects. I think in terms of your first question about the bills going through, I think it's important to recognise that there's huge diversity across Scotland. One size won't fit everywhere, and what works in one area won't necessarily work in another area. I think the key has to be that local empowerment, that local appreciation, and putting power in the community. We've seen what happens when people become disillusioned because they don't feel involved. I think there was some hinting about that in the earlier session as well, where we do need to encourage again that renewed sense of why people should be participating, what the benefits to the local community, and emphasise that localism and that diversity across Scotland has to be a key part of it. We've mentioned for a long time that principle of subsidiarity, you know, and that has to be a clear focus in anything going forward as well, to make sure that decisions are made by the people who are affected by them, and that we have that democratic accountability in the local area for those decisions being made. Obviously, community wealth building, which you mentioned in part of your question as well, you know, that there's a huge potential in community wealth building in order to support local areas and support that social and economic renewal. Obviously, local work, local jobs on a fair basis, with people being rewarded for the work they're doing, has a huge part to play in tackling poverties and inequalities across Scotland. And obviously, community wealth building has a lot to offer in that. It's supporting wealth being created and used in the local area for the benefit of local people, creating local jobs and supporting local businesses, and making sure that every penny spent in a local area brings back something to support the people who live there. So very much support community wealth building taken forward, and seeing local government very much, our councils are very much one of the anchor organisations in those local communities with the procurement powers that local government has, with the assets they have at their disposal to use with the community through community asset transfer or other schemes as well, and obviously through the people that councils employ. Councils are some of the largest employers in many of our areas across Scotland, and they can show a leadership role and take set an example in that. I think it's 240,000 people across Scotland are employed by local government. So, you know, there's a huge power in that as well. So community wealth building, recognising the local and creating the conditions in which that model can be developed would be obviously be something very much supported. You then moved on to the very small topic of the national care consultation. And I think our views on that are very clear. That local voice has to shine through in the way care is delivered. Supporting people in our communities now is absolutely essential, and that long-term structural change isn't seen as by us as being the way to secure the changes we need in terms of outcomes, in delivering social care, in delivering health outcomes, in improving well-being, and through that tackling inequalities and developing a human rights approach. That doesn't need structural change. It needs resource, it needs empowerment, it needs to be part of this fiscal, functional and community empowerment we've talked about beforehand, because many of the things we need to improve care in Scotland are things that are allied. You know, we won't be able to improve care unless we improve living in communities, and we won't be able to improve that unless we improve our leisure services, unless we improve the cultural services locally, unless employment for our staff is being on a fair basis as well. So there's lots in it that won't be answered by structural change, but could be answered now with crucial democratic accountability. So our lines on that are clear. A submission has been written and agreed at COSLA, and I know many councils have also agreed their submissions, and I see today that SOLAS as well, the Society of Chief Executives, has also put forward a similar view as well. So those submissions are in, and I think our view is clear. Democratic local accountability remains key. Structural change won't bring about the changes we need, but working with our local communities at the local level and strengthening local democratic accountability can bring about that change.
Thank you for that, Alison. I'm going to move on to some questions from Paul McClellan.
Yeah, thank you, convener. And Alison, thank you for your answer. It's kind of just leading on from your last question, and it was on around about across Scotland, only 18% of people feel they can influence decisions affecting their local area. Why do you think this is, and what are the barriers? And I know you kind of touched on that, but just to see if you wanted to add anything more in that regard.
Yes. I think it was interesting hearing the last session about the people who felt they'd been involved in the local governance review consultations and those that hadn't. I mean, I think there was an awful lot of effort to spread the Democracy Matters work across Scotland, and there was a communication made and events held in both communities of place and communities of interest. And I think, you know, I think that distinction is actually important as well. But as we heard, some people didn't feel that they were involved and didn't know much about it either. And I think there's a huge task for us in local government to support people to feel more involved and engaged in their communities. And I think a big part of that work is by people feeling empowered. If people feel that they can play part in decisions that affect them for outcomes in their local area, they are more willing to get involved. And at the moment, when we have increasing centralisation, when we have ring-fenced money, so councils are not in a position to say, yes, we'll support that local project, because councils, you know, don't have the resources to do that. And even if people come democratically up with a good solution, it's not possible to develop it for the reasons of lacking fiscal empowerment locally. I think if we can get over that and make localism more than a word. A lot of people are talking about localism, about 20-minute neighbourhoods, about place planning, and those things are all really important and really valuable to our communities. But we need to resource them to make them work, because they won't happen, as I've said, without people being involved. I think it's interesting as well, making sure that voices across our community are heard. And listening to Rona earlier about the comments she was making about why people aren't getting involved, that's something else we are working hard at COSLA to address. We're trying very hard to address the diversity of people standing for elected office as councillors. Many of the things in our councils at the moment that are seen as barriers, like times of meetings, organisation of meetings, you know, the more voices around the table asking for those things to be changed, the more they can be changed. They are things that go through a process of governance themselves that can be altered by voices around the table. And the willingness, of course, for people around that table already to reach out a hand and support people from diverse groups is there. The Improvement Service itself running mentoring sessions to encourage people to councils already in place to encourage others to get involved is very much there. So. I think diversity of voices is important. Giving that voice of lived experience a sense that it does make a difference is important. And I think they're things that we are working on, and again, would urge colleagues in the committee to support us and work with us on as well. Thank you.
Alison, thank you for that. The next question is moving away from that, and it's talking around about procurement. And it's really just to ask your comments on the percentage of procurement probably spent on local authorities, on local and social enterprises varies. And I'm just wondering, you know, what your thoughts are on that, and what more can be done to increase the proportion of procurement spent on local business and local social enterprises.
Thank you. And I think that's an aim across Scotland to use procurement in a most positive way to support local communities. And, you know, that spending power of local government, as I've said, is really important to be able to make a difference locally. But I'll pass on to Simon for a more detailed answer, please. Thank you. Simon.
Thank you, Councillor Evison. Apologies, could you repeat the question? My sound has been dipped out.
Yeah, Simon, just asking for your thoughts on the variation and percentage of procurement spent by local authorities on local business and on social enterprises, and what your views are and what more could be done to try and support that, you know, more spending on local social enterprises and local business in terms of procurement.
In terms of procurement, I mean, obviously that is an area that we can continue to kind of seek to make improvements in and look at supporting local enterprise. I think I would reflect on some of the work that's going through the participatory budgeting work, and apologies, easy for some to say, others not so, it's so easy. Is that reflecting in terms of the outcomes that we've seen in terms of that level of work and the rest, that actually by working with social enterprises, by showing that we can engage more effectively and meaningfully and get better levels of services, the levels of trust that Councillor Evison has been referring to and the rest have been growing throughout the period of COVID. And I think that trust building at the local level is somewhere where actually we can start to, through our procurement rules and regulations and the rest, start to make more leeway into developing that work locally and the rest. I think it just comes down to, as I say, that partnership working, the confidence that we've got to work together in that space, and making sure that the clear outcomes are there and shared at a local level. I think that's why it goes back down to understanding the local aspect as opposed to the national.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Paul. And now we've got a question from Megan, who's joining us virtually as well. Megan, ask your question.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Councillor Evison. I would like to touch on the subject of community councils and how, and indeed, should their roles be strengthened or changed? I think we saw during the pandemic some community councils flourished, but unfortunately some community councils have not been able to meet. So I would also like to hear your views in terms of how you think community councils are going to play a role as we head out of the pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you. I think community councils have a crucial role to play, and as a local councillor myself, I attend three in my ward on a regular basis as well, because it's important to have that engagement between elected councillors and our community councils as well. I think that many have struggled during the pandemic, though others haven't. Others have thrived in a local area, and I suppose that again shows the diversity across Scotland and shows the role that councils must have in supporting where there are issues and encouraging as well. It relates very much to the comments I've just given in answer as well about empowerment and people feeling that they can make a difference in their communities. The more there is a sense of people feeling they can make a difference, the more active our community councils can be. I think there is a need maybe to review some the organisation of some of our community councils and have some focus as well on that representation element of them, and how people become part of the community council and how the community council works across the local community to gather voices as well. I think we need to be very conscious all the time of equalities and making sure that we are supporting our community councils to have that equalities agenda and to look right across everyone in their communities as well. There is some tension sometimes between that community of place and that community of interest, and you know, our role in our local democratically elected local government is just try and support that work as well, and make sure that everything develops so that the voices of everyone across the community are heard, and that community councils are also a part of that human rights and equalities agenda. So I think there's general work to do on looking at that representative and that participatory democracy and working together on that. I think community councils have a huge role to play as we're moving forward with locality planning, as we're moving forward with empowerment as well. But again, that fiscal element is crucial in what we're doing moving forward. So very much see a role for community councils. They are a central part in our system throughout Scotland, especially in the local area, but working with them to promote equalities, to give that sense of empowerment, to give that sense of feeling people can make a difference, needs to be done as well. Thank you.
Thank you for that. And I'm going to move on to a couple of questions, our last questions you might be glad to hear, but thank you so much for the in-depth answers you've been giving us so far. We're going to move on to a couple of questions from Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, President and Simon. Thank you very much for making the time to come and speak to us today. As you both know, a big part of community fiscal empowerment is participatory budgeting. And obviously, this has been greatly impacted and interrupted by the COVID pandemic. And it's just to get a kind of a temperature check as to where you think we're at with the commitment to the 1% of council budgets being given over to communities for that fiscal empowerment of decisions. And do we think that there's some areas where we're seeing a standout progress and other areas that may be needing some more support? So it's just that kind of temperature check. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and good to see you again as well, Elena. There will, of course, be diversity across Scotland. You know, each council is a different starting point with this work, and COSLA is ready to give support where it's asked for, where it's needed, and that is our role as a organisation covering the whole of Scotland. So that is clear. I think the commitment to participatory budgeting is there. I think I touch again on that resource element as well, because you know these things can't happen without people there to make them happen, and I think it's really important to acknowledge that the pressure on council staff throughout COVID to help with resilience, to support recovery, has been intense. The finance coming into councils has not been as intense, if that's a way to put it there as well. But I think that the will is there, and as we're looking forward with the support that's available to be given through COSLA and colleagues in the Scottish Parliament as well, things can move forward from now. But we mustn't underestimate the work that's required to support it to happen and the resource needed to make it happen properly as well. It was interesting to hear that same comment made from community groups as well. They can't come forward for participatory budgeting either unless there is also resource there, unless there are also people with the skills, knowledge, experience to help drive it forward as well. So there is work to do, and we need to be committed as we are to that work in order to make this develop. But again, I'll pass it to Simon, because I know he's directly involved in this as well. Simon.
Thank you, Councillor Everson, and thank you for the question yet again. I think absolutely we're seeing across Scotland an affirmation of the commitment towards participatory budgeting in the race. And I think that although there has been the COVID delay as such, there has been an awful lot of work that has continued in the vein of things such as the console system, which is obviously an online system way of engaging with our local communities. That work has now spread across virtually all 32 councils, and we're starting to engage in different ways with the platform. I think one of the things that we remain committed to is not only that level of spend and commitment to participatory budgeting of the 1%, but is also actually defining for ourselves in Scotland what we mean by mainstream participatory budgeting, so that actually we do get into a space where people do feel they can engage in a manner that suits them best and actually affect decisions on it for their lives daily, either on a small local scale or across a wider area as well. So very much we've seen from both leaders in terms of the recent recommitment to the 1%, but also from elected members across Scotland, a willingness and an eagerness to develop local democracy through the use of participatory budgeting. I think just the affirmation from wider public sector partners would be something that would build on that. We're always quite clear that obviously from a local authority perspective, we've got our budgets, and as Councillor Everson rightly points out, there is a resource issue that's always tied to the engagement process that we go through. However, if we build on that with our partners, and they are committed as we are to engage with communities and work with them to make decisions in that way, that will be something that will continue to develop and promote that form of participatory democracy.
Thank you very much, both for those answers. I've got a wee change of direction now, and you know, stretched resources have made the quest for efficient government across all spheres of government something that we're needing to work towards. And I wonder whether there's a desire and a scope for councils to work more collectively over regions to deliver services, and if so, what needs to change in order for that to happen?
Thank you very much for that question. I mean, that relates very much to the functional empowerment bit of our three empowerments. We have been consistent throughout, and it was agreed with the Scottish Government before the election as well, that fiscal empowerment, community empowerment and functional empowerment need to work together, and that being able to collaborate where it's appropriate to collaborate is an important part of that functional empowerment. Now, you'll obviously know already that in some areas, you know, that there is working across council borders as well, in terms of economic development, in terms of some of the deals that are being done on a regional level, and in education and other areas as well, that, you know, there is already some coming together. I think the key to it has to be that councils are given that functional empowerment to come together with others where it is appropriate to do so. And that might be in with other councils working across a wider area because it makes sense in their local area to do that. It might be that functional empowerment is better delivered by enabling the council to come to where they'll say with the NHS to work at a closer level, or with the police and work at a closer level to deliver particular programmes locally with a preventative agenda, with a social renewal and economic renewal agenda. The key has to be that functional empowerment, where it is appropriate to do so, councils and public sector partners and the third sector can come to work together with shared objectives for better outcomes for their communities, and throughout with that human rights and person-centred approach as well. There's been various proposals across Scotland for things along these lines already. I must point out, obviously, that this single public service model that Orkney Council has very much had as part of their aspirations for a long time, and the pilot projects that stand ready for the local governance review as well do involve people working together. There's a proposal from the Ayrshires, for example, working together with Inverclyde on community advice services to members of the community who need that kind of advice. You know, there's programmes there standing ready to work on that basis. So it's important that functional empowerment is one of the three empowerments, and we do need to take it forward. We need to allow what happens, what's best for a local area, to happen at local area. But again, we need it to be across the public sector. It's not just councils cooperating with other councils. It must be other sectors of parts of the public sector able to work together as well with a local place-based focus to do what's best for a local community.
Thank you very much.
And that's the end of our questions. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. It's been good to hear the perspectives of COSLA. And if there's anything else that we just have a moment, if there's anything else you briefly want to say that you want to make sure we hear or you want to underscore, you've got a moment to do that. Otherwise, we'll conclude the meeting.
Just underscore, it's the local governance review, and it's really important that all aspects of the public sector work together on this. It is not something that local government can do on its own. And it's about improving outcomes for our communities, working from a position of trust to deliver and achieve the outcomes that I know we all share in terms of social and economic recovery. So trying to encourage that position of trust, as we've seen during the pandemic, moving forward with functional community and fiscal empowerment equally being taken forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alison, and thank you, Simon, for also joining us. I'm going to briefly suspend for a changeover of witnesses. Welcome back. Our third panel of witnesses to discuss the local governance review this morning has joined us in person, and I welcome John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Brian Logan, Local Governance Review Policy Manager, and Robin Hayes, Head of Council Tax Unit at the Scottish Government. And we will move straight to questions. And I'm going to start with the first couple of them. And I'd like to ask the about the Scottish Government's understanding of how the local governance review has progressed since May's elections and when it will conclude.
Good morning, Convener, and I'm very happy to address these issues with the committee this morning. The local governance review was started under the prior to the election. We've engaged substantively with the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities and on its development, and with wider stakeholders across the country in relation to the gathering of input and thinking consideration around the response to the review. From that, I suppose there are two substantive elements of feedback. First of all, there's the what I would describe as the general responses of members of the public and community organisations, some of which you will have heard this morning from a range of community organisations, reflecting on the accomplishments of communities, particularly during the pandemic, but not limited solely to the pandemic. And then the other grouping are a range of propositions that have emerged from local authorities and community planning partners about how some of the aspirations of the local governance review could be put into practice. And obviously the government is considering some of these proposals and will respond to each of the proposals with our feedback on the issues and the aspirations that are raised within those propositions. So that's essentially what we're focused on in the aftermath of the review. There's obviously this forms part of the agenda that then plays into the taking forward of a local democracy bill during this parliamentary term to which the government is committed.
Thank you for that response. Local government has long been calling for a fiscal framework that could bring greater clarity, certainty and transparency to local government finance. It's been very encouraging that a fiscal framework is currently being developed by the Scottish Government and COSLA, but the notice of potential strike action from up to 200,000 council workers across Scotland emphasises that change is needed urgently. I'd like to ask the Deputy First Minister and Mr. Haynes for a progress update on the fiscal framework, and I'd also welcome a reassurance that the framework will deliver new or enhanced revenue-raising powers for councils.
These are issues of ongoing consideration within government and in our dialogue with the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities. I can't give you the definitive assurance you seek in the question, Convener, because these issues are still the subject of consideration. The Finance Secretary is leading the work on the development of a rules-based fiscal framework. That will be the subject of current discussion with local government, and will be concluded when those discussions are completed. So the Finance Secretary will be able to update the committee and Parliament on the development of the fiscal framework once that work has been undertaken. I think it's important to recognise that there are already, and have been for many years, significant flexibilities available to local government for their own financial management. And if we go back to 2007, the Scottish Government, I was the Finance Secretary at the time, substantively relaxed ring fencing, for example, which was a key request of local government, to enable local government to have a range of flexibilities at its disposal. And and that of itself provided local government with much greater fiscal discretion to address its issues. Now, when we come on to the discussion and the debate about industrial action, I'm not altogether sure I would establish a connection between industrial action in local authorities or proposed industrial action and a fiscal framework for local government. I think these are two distinct issues. It is, of course, a matter for local government to conduct its employee relationships and negotiations where it is appropriate for it to do so. It does that with the majority of local authority employees. Teachers are somewhat different, where there's a tripartite negotiating framework in place. But fundamentally, it's for local authorities as employers to take forward that relationship. And I wouldn't think that it's necessarily an issue that's directly related to a fiscal framework.
Thank you for your response. And we're going to take questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Swinney, and good morning to the panel as well. I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to the National Care Service, because over a number of sessions we've been hearing concerns about the impact of a National Care Service on local governance. So I wanted to ask specifically what impact the Scottish Government's proposals for a National Care Service has had on the local governance review, given COSLR specifically have expressed concerns about its wide proposals and the impact on local democracy.
I think one of the key points that has been made by the government as part of the thinking around the National Care Service, which is of course the subject of consultation at the present moment and which has been sustained by the government throughout, is the importance of ensuring there is appropriate local voice is heard within the whole approach to a National Care Service. So it's vital that we have the ability to hear and to engage with local communities around the delivery of care services. They matter for local communities. They will be different in different parts of the country, so there has to be variation and variety in the way in which the service is delivered. So it's critical that we hear the voice of local communities within the development of the National Care Service. That's been a fundamental point. And I accept that the proposals are, the local government has got particular observations about the proposals, but it's important that we hear the voices of individuals who are pressing the government. This was evident in the independent review around issues on consistency of service performance and delivery in different parts of the country, about the standards that can be expected by citizens in all parts of the country. And these are, of course, two very fundamental questions that have to be wrestled with within the discussions of the National Care Service.
Thank you for that answer. I think the committee welcomed the fact that you've put on record that the government intend to bring forward a local democracy bill. But one of the fundamental things I think we have been hearing, and I hear what you say in terms of people knowing that their voice has been heard, but a lot of the concerns relate to where powers will actually reside. And, you know, the Parliament's voted for a European Charter Bill, which looked towards making sure those powers are, you know, respected by local government. I think where it's difficult for the committee to see the government's approach on this is there seems to be a fundamental contradiction between a National Care Service and these other streams of work, which should look towards the powers of local government being protected. So I just wonder if you had any view on that, given these work streams which seem to contradict each other.
Well, Obi, you know, I fundamentally come at my politics from the point of view that decisions are best taken as close to people as they possibly can be. That's why I believe in Scottish independence. I think that's important, that people are able to influence and shape the decisions that affect their lives. But ultimately, there is a discussion and a debate to be had about where are the proper arrangements for democratic governance to be exercised. We have a National Health Service, for example. I don't hear any sustained argument. I don't hear any argument, actually, for suggesting that the National Health Service should in some way be changed from its current composition and made into something more localised than it, in terms of its governance, than it actually is. and obviously ministers are accountable to the Scottish Parliament for the delivery of National Health Service functions as provided for in statute. So there will be decisions taken, and obviously it's for Parliament to take these decisions, it's not solely for the government to take these decisions, about where the responsibility is best exercised for those functions. I think there's also I think a substantive issue that the committee needs to consider in relation to its work on local governance, which is about, you know, where is Parliament's view on some questions of accountability? Because I frequently hear, indeed I answer questions on this basis on a regular basis from members of Parliament, where members of Parliament will be pressing the government to be responsible or to account for certain things that have happened which are exclusively not the responsibility of the government but are in fact the responsibility of local authorities or other bodies. But Parliament acts in a fashion that essentially wants the government to be accountable for some of these responsibilities. So I don't think the question is just for the government about some of these points. The question also arises for Parliament to be clear in its mind about what it wants to, where it believes accountability should rest and how that accountability should be exercised.
Thank you for those responses. We're going to now take a question from Megan Gallagher, who's joining us online.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Deputy First Minister. I would like to hear your views on the balance in terms of those local authority budgets that are ring-fenced and those that are not, and I know you've touched on that slightly. And in addition, if you'd be able to comment on the combination of a reduced budget settlement and ring-fencing and the impact that this could have on councils in Scotland being able to make decisions at a local level which benefit their communities.
I think the, you know, the debate on ring fencing is not a precise science, and I wouldn't for a moment suggest that it is. It is a question of judgment, as I indicated in my earlier responses to the convener. The government in 2007 substantively relaxed ring fencing in local authorities. I used to know these numbers off the top of my head, but it's all a little bit rusty nowadays. But, I think we reduced ring fencing to something like about 15% of the local authority budgets when it had previously been as high as about 70 or 75. And we did that because local government put forward an argument that indicated they would be better able to meet the needs of their local community in terms of financial decision making by having the greater degree of flexibility that was envisaged. And that's the point that lies really at the heart of Ms. Gallagher's question, that local authorities have that flexibility to meet the different and distinctive needs within their localities, because what one local authority needs to, the demand they need to meet is going to be different from another. And we've tried to meet that as far as possible. I think where we've found ourselves, and some of this relates to some of my responses to the questions that Mr. Briggs has put to me this morning, is that where Parliament wants the government to make sure particular outcomes are achieved, then, and the government may wish to do that as well, then the tendency can be to introduce funding which will have a ring-fenced character about it to make sure that we can be certain that resources are released in expectation of certain outcomes being achieved. So that, that's often the judgment that is involved in whether resources should be ring-fenced or whether they should be put into the general funds of local authorities. I think in relation to the latter point of Ms. Gallagher's question about the budgets available for local authorities, the government has obviously wrestled with a lot of financial challenges over the course of the last 10 years, principally, as we've wrestled with the, the challenges of austerity. We've tried to deliver the best and strongest settlements we possibly could do for local authorities. Parliament, of course, has got to agree budget provisions, and there is always the opportunity available to political parties to shape the government's budget proposals by the influence that can be exerted over those budget proposals, and that will be the subject of debate in the forthcoming budget. But I think one of the things that strengthens the ability of local authorities to meet the needs within their communities is the degree of flexibility the government has provided for those local authorities by relaxing ring fencing.
Thank you for that. I just want to come in on a supplementary on that. In speaking with Councillor Everson, she talks about, in relation to ring fencing, she talks about if we can get around agreed outcomes. Her approach is, can we get around agreed outcomes and a level of trust and then therefore be able to move away from ring fencing? And I just wonder if you can...
There's undoubtedly a discussion to be had there, but I'd have to also inject the word performance into that as well, because I think some of the reasons why we have to introduce ring fencing is because we see too great a variation in performance amongst local authorities in the country. Some local authorities may be very good at delivering outcomes in certain areas, and other local authorities are poor at so doing. And Parliament, quite understandably, I think, pressurises the government to make sure that performance is at a higher level. Now, we've tried a number of different ways. I took forward, as part of the Concordat with local authorities in 2007, the concept of single outcome agreements, where we tried to reduce the reporting burden on local authorities by putting in place agreements with local authorities about, by relaxing ring fencing, what could we expect to be achieved in terms of the outcomes for local authorities. I have to say, the response to that and the achievement of outcomes was highly variable around the country, and the evidence supports that. So I'm not in any way closed in my mind to that, but there would have to be an honest reflection of the fact that performance amongst local authorities is just too variable around the country for us to be able to confidently move into that territory at this particular stage.
I'm going to follow up there. I'm just curious now, do we have any evidence around why there's a variability on the performance?
I think there's available evidence from the Accounts Commission around their scrutiny of the way in which individual services are delivered. Indeed, the Improvement Service do a lot of very good work on charting the relative performance of local authorities and the range of differences in individual service areas can be really quite difficult to justify, I think. And that's based on the Improvement Service is there to try to help local authorities to deliver their improvements. I very much applaud the Improvement Service for the work that they undertake, because they are prepared to confront the fact that there is a variation in performance amongst local authorities, which I think, if we're going to have an honest conversation about this point, has to be addressed. So that these reports, either from the Accounts Commission or the Improvement Service, tend to give an insight service by service about where some of the differences lie.
Thank you very much for that. We're going to move on to questions from Paul McClellan.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Deputy First Minister and panel. Deputy First Minister, we've had an evidence session the past few weeks and today talking around about the desire for multi-year spending commitments from local government and from local services. I'm just wondering, with the UK Government's publication of their spending review, multi-year spending review last week, will this enable Scottish Government to publish local government with multi-year settlements?
Mr. McLennan is tempting me onto territory which is the proper preserve of the Finance Secretary, which I'll refrain from getting myself into difficulty with the Finance Secretary at this particular time in the budget cycle. It's never a good idea for a Cabinet Secretary to get themselves into trouble with the Finance Secretary, so I shall leave Ms. Forbes to update the committee on the substance of that point. But as a general observation, I would say that in recent years, and some of this has been wholly understandable because of COVID and other factors, the UK government has, well, COVID, Brexit, you name it, has been unable to offer longer-term financial information. We've got a much greater line of sight in the forthcoming period than we have had, so that's very welcome. But as to how that is then handled by the Finance Secretary, I shall leave for Ms Forbes to share with the committee.
Okay, I've got another question. This might be tempting again for Ms Forbes to answer this question. COSLA obviously had a blueprint for local government, and one of the things they mentioned around about was having more powers to raise and set taxes, more discretion for, I suppose, local authorities to do that. Again, just to get your view on that. And again, I know that kind of falls into the Finance Secretary again, but just your views on that point.
There are, of course, discussions that we are taking forward practically on that subject with local authorities. There are discussions underway around about the proposals in relation to, I can't remember its former title, but this concept of tourist taxes that are being looked at. So there is the appetite to have that discussion with local authorities if they wish to do so.
Thank you for that. And we're going to now take a question from Mark Griffin, who's also joining us online.
Thanks, Camilla. According to the 2019 Scottish Household Survey, only 18% of people think they can influence decisions affecting their local area, and that seems to be a significant reduction since the passing of the Community Empowerment Act. And I'd just like to ask the Deputy First Minister why he thinks that's the case. You know, what are the barriers stopping people influencing decisions, and how the local governance review might address that?
I think Mr. Griffin's question raises a very serious point, because ultimately, if we go back to the question of outcomes, what outcome are we interested in achieving with all of this activity? And the outcome must be that individuals feel that they are able to shape the direction of their community and the way in which their lives are placed within that community. So the statistics that Mr. Griffin puts to me are concerning, that there might well be a decline. I think, interestingly, during the course of the pandemic, in a situation of extremis, I think the degree of community leadership, interaction, decision-making, adaptation was at a higher level than I have seen it for many, many years in my experience. So I think what that tells us is it's perfectly possible for communities to be much more closely involved in shaping their agenda and their direction as a consequence of the interventions they take. But what we've got to make sure is that communities are not, in a sense, disengaged from that process, or find that process much more difficult to participate in by the way in which we structure such processes. So I think it's up to local authorities to make sure that they are putting off, as I think they did during the pandemic, a welcoming invitation to communities to shape the nature of the response that is taken forward in individual communities. But that we've got to make sure that that happens not just in a pandemic, but it happens all the time. And that's one of the fundamental points of the COVID recovery strategy that I put to Parliament before the October recess, which is about trying to ensure that we capture and continue to mobilise that sense of community discretion and influence, which has been such an asset to us during the pandemic.
Thank you for that response. And we're going to now move on to different subject and questions from Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Deputy First Minister. Thank you for coming along and speaking with us today. You will be aware of the recently published international review that was conducted by the Local Governance Review Team. Quebec, where I grew up, is one of the case studies, and despite the gradual growth in municipal powers over the last decade and nearly all local budgets being raised through local taxation, there has not yet been a significant increase in citizen participation. So which countries and examples from the review are getting the relationships and the resource allocations between the different spheres of government right?
I think it's difficult to make a judgment about individual systems. I think what the international review can do is it can help to inform our deliberations here about what are the right factors and considerations for us to have. But fundamentally, the processes that appear to me through the international review to be having the greatest degree of effect are the ones which are providing sufficient opportunity and scope for communities to shape their own contribution to the way in which their priorities are determined. So that, I suppose, would perhaps best be described as a more permissive approach to this, the scope and the influence of local communities. And then the second dimension, I think, is around about fiscal decision making, where I think some of the examples that have been cited have, in a sense, reflected the choices that are made by individual local communities as being of a character that can enable them to take much more responsibility for taking fiscal decisions about their own well-being. And that essentially, I think, comes down to, and this is, you know, I'm not going to suggest that this is easily replicable in this country, where there's a degree of tolerance of difference of levels of local taxation and local responsibility, individual area by individual area. And I think, I'm not sure that we would be able to sustain the argument, or that argument would be so as well received in Scotland as it is perhaps in other examples in the international review.
Thank you very much for your answer. As we've just heard from the COSLA president and her evidence, functional empowerment is a key aspect of the local governance review. Can I ask you, Deputy First Minister, considering efficient government is within your own remit, whether more regional and collaborative approaches to service delivery as a Scottish government commitment?
I'm interested throughout this in what is the right level at which decision making should be undertaken and discretion should be exercised. And again, to come back to the argument that I put forward in response to Megan Gallagher, I don't think there's a precise science argument to this answer to this either. I worry about individual communities feeling a sense of a loss of control over what happens in their own individual locality. So if I think about the areas that in the communities that I represent, there are individual towns within my constituency, and Helena Whittemore represents a very similar type of area in terms of composition of population, where in the past a very significant amount of civic discretion was exercised within those communities, which created a sense of focus within those communities. Indeed, that was reactivated, frankly, during the pandemic. So if I think about all the really successful, impactful developments that took place during the pandemic, most of them, not all of them, most of them happened in these local communities that I talk about, substantial towns where people came together. They could put in place fixes to make sure everybody was looked after. It was in colleagues that are that represent similar areas to me will know exactly what I'm talking about. I feel a lot of that has been eroded for many years, probably since local government reorganisation in the 1970s. And it's been there's been a sense of loss within communities about that. Now, there have been over the years many good examples of how that sense of loss has been addressed by good community endeavour within those communities. When you then move away from some of these functions, which are fundamentally about locality, about the sense of community and the pride in the community. And you come to some of the more sophisticated delivery of public services, which Parliament legislates for, which can often carry some significantly onerous burdens on the delivery of those public services, particularly around the quality of public services in areas like adult and child protection. I worry that the delivery of those services across 32 local authority areas, where the population base of some of those local authority areas will be dramatically smaller than other areas, but the burdens are the same. The burdens that Parliament applies to the delivery of a child protection service for the city of Glasgow is exactly the same as it applies for Clackmannanshire Council. And we expect it to be the assurance to be offered on the same basis. But obviously, the handling of cases will be a more frequent issue within the city of Glasgow than it will be in the Clackmannanshire area because of the difference in size. Which is why, and I took forward a number of these different steps when I was Education Secretary, the encouragement of collaboration amongst local authorities was a particular priority. So again, if I think about the area that I represent in Perth and Kinross, there has been a great deal of collaboration amongst the three authorities, Dundee, Angus and Perth and Kinross, around some of the delivery and the improvement of education services and child wellbeing services across the whole of those three council areas. And I see significant improvements arising as a consequence of that. So I think operating at that multi-authority collaborative level is really welcome. Now, that shouldn't be interpreted as the government committing to forcing that upon people, because I don't think that's a particularly good way to proceed. But if I do reflect on my experience as Education Secretary, in 2016, when I advanced the concept of regional improvement collaboratives, there was, I would have to say, a fair amount of hostility and resistance to it. And once people actually got into a room and started talking about some of their challenges, and started talking about the common themes, and Ms Whittam will have seen this from her experience in Ayrshire amongst the three local authority areas there, and the collaboration that could come out of that, I think was pretty beneficial for children and young people within Scotland. And indeed, one of the pillars of the educational response to the pandemic was the West of Scotland Improvement Collaborative, which took forward a huge amount of excellent work in the recording of online learning, which was then made available right across the country on a choice basis to school pupils, families, teachers, other local communities right across the country because of the common platform that we created around the eSchool, but a fundamental source of thousands of lessons that were recorded was the West of Scotland Collaborative. I pay warm tribute to everybody who was involved in that, because it was a sterling piece of work that helped in the delivery of education. So there is very much a space for collaboration amongst local authorities. I think what was achieved in education between 2016 and 2021, against the background of a lot of hostility and scepticism to the concept, was actually something that helped us enormously to deliver sustainable education during the pandemic.
Is it okay if I just come back really quickly with a little point on that? Deputy First Minister, you said something that was really quite key to me there, you know, the reorganisation of local government in the 1970s. And I think we're still seeing an effect of that nowadays. If you listen to people who don't feel empowered in their communities, they hark back to their borough council, their town council, where they had one councillor, they had a set of people that met locally within that area, and that one big representative that went to, you know, a wider national body. How do we, at this point in time where we still have our population that still harks back to those days, how do we make sure that the local governance review delivers that community empowerment, that functional and that devolved power to local communities that we need it to?
We've got to do that by creating the space to enable communities to essentially advance that agenda. I don't think there is merit in replicating the sort of borough council model that was in place in prior to the 1975 local government reorganisation. But what I do think, and I see this in communities I represent and in other communities around the country, one of the great privileges of my office is that I am able to see it firsthand, good innovations brought forward. And I can think about particular developments which emerge perhaps, for example, through the work of development trusts, for example, where you can see community capacity being able to be built up year after year after year by communities committing, for example, I'm not prescribing this as a route through this, to a concept of a development trust, or it might be a scheme, and that brings together some community industry. It enables developments to take place, other propositions grow from that, and communities are then able to exercise much greater distinctive delivery of services and purpose within a community. And then a positively engaged local authority will recognise this is happening and will seek to engage with those communities to try to make sure that more functions can be deployed in that locality in a way that has the impact that we all seek within those communities. And that may well perhaps address some of the points that Mr. Griffin put to me about to what extent do people feel as if they can shape their local community agenda. And there are some very good practices around the country where local authorities do enable much greater discretion to be exercised at local level. And if that can be done in partnership with the development of some of these concepts of development trusts or SCEOs or wider community engagement activities, then I think that can perhaps address the fundamental point that I recognise that Elena Whittam puts to me about the sense of remoteness that people feel from public authority when they live in some of these communities and are anxious to be able to better shape the future of their community.
Thank you.
I think Miles Briggs would like to come in with a supplementary.
I was interested in the responses you were given to the committee on that, Deputy First Minister, because I think there's also an element of the cost of delivering services as well, which we need to look at. Now, I say that through the eyes of being an Edinburgh MSP and know the challenges and the cost of living here in the capital, but particularly Edinburgh City Council and NHS Lothian being the two lowest funded councils and health boards per head of population. So I wanted to ask, has there been any consideration about the cost of delivering services and a potential, for example, to deliver an Edinburgh waiting? Because we know that both the council and health board continuously report that delivering the workforce, but also cost of delivering services, be it buying land and things like that, is fundamentally more expensive here in the capital. So I just wondered whether or not the government had pursued any work around that.
I recall some discussion of these points in the past. I think I'd, to be on the safe side, I think I'd better write to the committee about any specific work that's been undertaken. But of course, if I go back to the issues around local government finance, I suppose there's two points that are relevant here. Firstly, the distribution formula of funding within amongst local authorities is a matter of dialogue and agreement with local authorities. So if there was to be any proposition to change the distribution of funding within local authority areas, that would obviously be an issue that we would that would have to be agreed by local authorities. And I think there's a certain reluctance to discuss the distribution formula within local authorities at the present moment, and has been generally the case. Second point I would make is that, of course, in previous budgets, and this factor must still be in the budget settlements, we agreed a particular supplement for the City of Edinburgh. It was a point I negotiated with the late Margaret MacDonald in the 2007 to 2011 Parliament, and that will be factored into the budget arrangements that we have in place. So there are, of course, ways of discussing these issues, and on the health board funding, that is, of course, determined by the NRAC arrangements, and there are steps that have been taken over time to address exactly the issue that Mr. Briggs puts to me.
To come in, kind of picking up, going to another area, which is that we heard, so we've been talking about this kind of in a context of coming out of COVID and recovery, and I think also quite fittingly in the context of the climate and nature emergencies, how can communities be empowered at a local level to make the responses for, I think Alison Everson was talking about localism, how can we really make that real? And one of the things that we heard this morning from one of the community panel members was a need for spaces for meeting and the skills for convening and facilitating and also for paying people for that time. And I just wonder if that's something that's being considered by the Scottish Government. And I could imagine it might be something that's going to kind of present itself in the local democracy bill and the community wealth building bills.
These issues are all fundamentally about address some of the points I was discussing earlier with Elena Whittam, which are about how you build up capacity within a community to be able to exercise some of these influences. I think if you were to pitch up at a community and say, you know, here's a couple of £100,000 to do things in your community. In some communities, they would be able to handle that absolutely without any difficulty whatsoever because they have got a certain degree of capacity, probably built up through the establishment of a development trust. There may be a bit of proceeds of a wider revenue sources, for example, from communities in my constituency, benefit from proceeds from renewable energy projects, so they have some resources that can enable them to build up capacity. But however it happens, there has to be capacity within a community to handle things. You can't just pitch up at a community and say to a group of volunteers, here you are, on you go, and, you know, good luck. There has to be capacity there, and that has to be actively built up. I think this is a proper opportunity for local authorities to work with local communities to do that, to activate other sources of funding, whether it's through common good funds or sources such as renewable energy funds or a variety of other vehicles. But fundamentally, I would be very supportive, the government would be very supportive about the building up of that capacity. Because what it then enables communities to do is to choose where they can exercise the greatest degree of influence and deliver the greatest degree of impact. So if I think back to, you know, again, to my own community at the weekend, we had a day of biblical weather on Sunday in my constituency, and in one town which has been blighted by flooding before, in the town of Aileth, there is a real activation of community activity and engagement on a whole variety of different issues, but specifically on the question of flooding. So as the issues became severe on Sunday, the community was activated and volunteers were undertaking work to support others, to protect others, to put infrastructure in place. The community has been able to procure, through partnership with the local authority, supplies of sandbags to be available for temporary deployment to deal with circumstances as they arise. Volunteers were making that all happen on Sunday. The community has some of these temporary flood defences that start off looking like something like pillows and end up weighing a ton once they're wet, and they were all being deployed and very good outcomes were delivered, but there is some capacity in there to make that happen, which then engages the community. And all of this is done through some community capacity, social media, and a really engaged local community. Perfect example of what I'm talking about in an extreme situation. And we will all have communities who are operating on these bases. So I think the challenge is, how do we make that a reliable, dependable feature on an ongoing basis of our delivery of public services? Now, the government can't prescribe that from St Andrew's House, and it would be folly for us to try to do that. Good dialogue and discussion with local authorities is, I think, essential. And the right outlook of local authorities, because if local authorities enter into that conversation thinking we must control everything, we must run everything, then they will put off local engagement. But if there's a welcoming spirit to embrace what might be possible for a community to handle, then I think we can see an awful lot more thriving as a consequence.
Thank you for that response. And that concludes our questions. So thank you very much for joining us this morning, and also to Robin Haynes and Brian Logan for being with us, and now suspend the meeting temporarily. The third item on the agenda for the committee is to consider the Town and Country Planning Local Place Plan Scotland Regulations 2021. And we'd like to know if there are any comments from committee members. I see no comments. So I'd like to know if the committee has agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument. All agreed. Thank you.
The committee will now move into private session as agreed earlier in the meeting.